On to elementary principles of derivative pricing. So before we actually go into pricing of derivatives, or before we actually go into valuation of derivatives, which is next meeting, we will just take an overview, or we will just discuss some basic principles on which derivative pricing is done, or on which derivatives are priced or valued. So first concept is of storage or storage cost. What is the storage? So let's say there is a commodity, let's say oil. So if you want to get exposure to oil, you have two options. Either you buy it today, or you enter into a forward contract to buy it after some point of time, after 1 month, 2 month, or whatever. Forward contract, future contract, option, or whatever. Mostly derivatives are for future. So either you can buy it today, or you can enter into a contract to make a transaction or buy it at some point in future. If you buy it today, you will have to store it till you use it. So that means, and if you store it, there would be a storage cost. So that means if you buy it today, you will have to incur some storage cost. But if you buy it later, after 1 month or 2 months, when your use comes up, then there wouldn't be any storage cost, or storage cost will be lower. Why? Because when you can just go and buy, you can buy it using the forward contract at the time when you actually need to use it. So that means if you are going for derivative, then actually buying an asset, you are saving some storage cost. So if you are saving some storage cost, who is bearing this? The counterparty is bearing this. So that means the person who is taking a long position, or is taking a buying position in the derivative, is actually saving storage cost, and the counterparty is actually bearing those storage costs. So if A and B are entering into a contract, A is, for example, have a long position. So A is saving some storage costs, and B is incurring some additional storage costs if it is a short position. So in this case, B would ask for a higher price, or whatever price B asks for, B would incorporate a component of storage cost into that price. So that means for derivative pricing, you need to build in a component of storage cost. So that is first basic concept related to derivative pricing. That is, you should build in a component for storage cost. And generally, financial assets wouldn't have storage costs, right? Yes. So any confusion so far? So moving on, another concept is that although A is saving storage cost, A is also losing on convenience. So convenience is higher for B. Why higher for B? And why is A losing convenience? A is losing convenience that because if during this time A wants oil immediately, or if a need comes up to use oil immediately, A wouldn't have access to that particular oil. So that means A is losing some convenience or some benefit. Sorry? Yes, exactly. So A does not have it. If A has the asset with itself, then there is more convenience. Why? Because A does not know how would the demand and supply conditions change in future. Maybe in future oil is not even present and oil is not being supplied. Then A wouldn't be able to use it or get it. So if you are holding the asset, there is a convenience, additional convenience, and that convenience is lost if you are entering into a derivative contract. So that means although A is saving storage cost, A is losing some convenience. And who has this convenience? B has this convenience. So if A is losing the convenience, A will ask it to be adjusted in the price. A would want to pay a lower price for derivative. Yes, due to convenience. So that means there needs to be one convenience factor as well. So for A, what would just any confusion so far? Right, so convenience, this is known as, so the benefit that you get due to this convenience is known as convenience yield. Any other questions? Okay, so Then there can be other benefits. Like for example, maybe there is a stock which A is buying. Let's say stock of company X or equity of company X, equity share of company X. And let's say that this share pays a dividend. So if this share pays a dividend during the life of the or before the expiration of the contract, who would receive this dividend? A has a long position. That means A hasn't bought the asset. A will buy it in future. Who holds the asset today? B. So that means if a dividend comes up, B will receive that dividend. So that means there will be other benefits like dividend as well, which B will receive and A will lose out. This means that this dividend should then also be adjusted in the price calculation, right? Because A is foregoing this benefit. So if A is foregoing this benefit, A would want to get it adjusted in the price. A would want to pay a lower price than otherwise. Anyone having any confusion, any problem, any question? Yes. So if a stock pays a dividend, A has a long position in this stock in a derivative contract, which means A will buy this in future. Today, who holds it today? B holds it as of today. So that means today asset stays with the B, with B. In future, it will be transferred to A. So if it pays a dividend today, who will receive it?
B.
So if B is receiving a dividend, that means A is foregoing this dividend. A would have received it, but now B is receiving it. Yes.
And is the holding cost incorporated or some percentage of the dividend is incorporated?
So it depends when the dividend is being paid. So you take time value of money from that particular time period till the expiration. In everything you decide when would the time when that particular actually action or transaction would be done, and from that you calculate the time value of money. So that means this dividend or any other benefit needs to need also be adjusted. Which means if B is valuing the asset, if B is calculating the price of asset or value of asset, that value of asset would be some base value, whatever it is. And then B is receiving. For B, what will be the value? The for B, value would also be convenience, because B has convenience over it. For B, the value will also be any dividend. And for B, the loss of value would be storage cost. And so these all these adjustments will need to be made in order to arrive at the value of that asset for B. And when A is taking a position in derivative, opposite of this will happen. That is, A will start with a base value. Then A will say that I am not receiving convenience, so I want to make an adjustment for that convenience. I am not receiving dividend, so I need to make an adjustment for that dividend. And I wouldn't be bearing the storage cost, so I can make an adjustment for the storage cost. Yes. Okay, so any problem with this basic concept? So that means if you are pricing derivative, then you will add storage cost, subtract convenience or dividend. That means add cost, subtract benefit. In summary would be that add cost, subtract benefit in derivative pricing. If you are pricing the underlying, then you will add benefit, subtract cost. So remember, when you are pricing underlying, you will add benefit, subtract cost. Why? Because that benefit is associated with that particular underlying. When you are pricing derivative, you will add cost and subtract benefit. Anyone having any question? Yes. So storage done, convenience yield done. Moving on, like one of the basic or most important or key concepts in derivative pricing is arbitrage. So remember that derivative pricing assumes a no arbitrage situation or an arbitrage free market. Derivative pricing is always based on the assumption that market is arbitrage free. What is arbitrage? Yes, so
exchange,
So वो तो gain होगा ना, if you are getting a benefit in undervalued and overvalued thing.
The derivative to buy in Pakistan and the derivative to buy in America should have one price.
Okay. And the difference will be arbitrage. So arbitrage opportunity or arbitrage trade is a trade in which you make a gain with no risk and no investment. So if you make a gain with no risk and no investment, that trade is known as arbitrage trade, or that transaction is known as arbitrage transaction. And the market where these opportunities are present, that market is known as arbitrage free market. Okay, so moving on, what is arbitrage trade or arbitrage market, or how does this opportunity comes up? So let's say that there is an asset A, or let's say there is an asset X, and there are two markets A and B. Let's say this asset X is selling for $100 in market A, and it is selling for $102 in market B. So what you can do is you can buy it here and sell it in any other market and make a return without taking any risk. So it is assumed that there is no risk. So you buy it here and sell it in another market and you make a profit. This is known as arbitrage trade. But eventually arbitrage opportunities or arbitrage trades or arbitrage transactions lead to market efficiency. How do they lead to market efficiency? So when you buy it here, when you start buying it here, prices will start going up. And when you sell it here, supply will increase and so prices will decrease. And so eventually prices will immediately converge. So that means arbitrage trade leads to market efficiency. And once the prices have converged, that market is known as arbitrage free market. Yes.
So how come there is no investment when you are buying an order?
Yes, there is no investment because you can sell it first here and then buy it here. So you can short sell and then buy. So short sell means selling something which you do not own. So you can borrow from someone, sell it in one market and buy it another market and return it to that person. Okay, so prices will start going up in one market and will start falling in another market, and the prices will eventually converge until an equilibrium is reached. So that means as arbitrage, if an arbitrage opportunity opens up, investors will start trading on it and eventually it will be closed. Why? Because prices will eventually converge. So arbitrage transactions also lead to contributes to increasing the market efficiency. Because if there are no arbitrage transactions, or if they are restricted or regulators do not allow them, then these trades wouldn't happen and the prices will remain be different. So derivatives assume, or derivative pricing assumes, one of the key or fundamental concepts of derivative pricing is that arbitrage opportunities does not exist in the market and market is arbitrage free. So remember, in pricing models or valuation models, this will be the underlying assumption or key assumption that markets are arbitrage free. Okay, so how does arbitrage contribute to market efficiency, anyone? Sorry? Yeah, so in the market where price is higher, the supply would increase and so the price will eventually fall. And in the market where price is lower, the demand will increase and so eventually price will go up, and both of these will converge. And as prices converge, obviously market efficiency increases, because market efficiency means that similar options or prices should be available to the different investors or to all the investors. Any questions so far? Yes. So if you have a market where you have asset being priced at $10 and you have another market where same asset is selling for $12. So what would happen? Investors would buy it here and sell it here. When they start selling it, price will decrease, and when they start buying it here, price will increase. So when they do arbitrage transaction, or when they perform arbitrage transaction, eventually price will start to converge. That means eventually price will become same. So maybe it becomes 11 here, or it becomes 11 here as well. So eventually prices will converge. That means by the arbitrage transactions, or by engaging into arbitrage transactions, prices can be converged. And when prices converge, market efficiency improves. Because if same asset is selling for same value throughout the market, we would call that market to be. So short selling means that you borrow an asset and then you sell the asset, and when price goes down or later some point when you want to close this position, you buy the asset from market and return the asset to the party from which you borrowed it. So if let's say there is A and B, A thinks that price will go down, so A can borrow asset from B and go and sell it in another market, or maybe borrow and keep it with it, and later when price goes down, A can buy it again from the market and return it to B. This is known as short sell. So for short selling, you do not really require an asset. What you are simply doing is you are taking an asset from someone, selling it, and then returning it to that particular person. Okay, now the next question. Key point to note is that we discussed that this arbitrage transaction is actually risk-free, or we discussed that it is to make a profit with a zero risk. But actually there is a risk involved. And what is that risk? Let's say price is $10 here and $12. And the investor is buying it here and selling in another market. So what is the risk? Once he has bought it here, he would need to go and sell it. Or once he has short sell it here, then he will need to go and buy it. So the chances are that there will be some time lag, right? So you will first go into one market and buy something, and you will go to another market and sell it. So chances are that by the time he reaches here to buy it, maybe price has gone up to $12, or maybe price has gone up to $13 or whatever. So, or when he goes to sell it here, maybe price has gone down to $10 or $11, whatever. So that means there is some inherent risk in the arbitrage transaction, and that is a limit to arbitrage. So this inherent risk actually limits the arbitrage possibility or arbitrage transaction. That is, even if there is an arbitrage opportunity, maybe investors wouldn't get into it. Why? Because they might think that volatility is so high that by the time they go to sell or buy it, price would have changed. So there is some inherent risk, and that risk actually limits the arbitrage activity. Secondly, another key point to notice, another limit to arbitrage is, taking the same example again. So let's say there is same asset trading in two different markets. You can buy it for $10 and sell it for $11 in another market. But when you buy it, you will face some commission. So let's say the commission is $0.6. And when you sell it, you will again pay some commission. So let's say the commission is $0.6 again. Which means, although there is a difference of $1, although you can make a profit of $1, but the cost of making that $1 profit is $1.2. That is, first you will buy it and spend $0.6, and then you will sell it and again spend $0.6. So you have actually made a profit of $1, but you have spent $1.2 in the transaction, which means on net basis it is a loss and not a profit. So this is another limit to arbitrage, that if commissions are high, or if commissions more than offset, or the transaction cost, not actually only commission, if the transaction costs more than offset the benefit of arbitrage trade, then arbitrage trade obviously wouldn't happen, or investors wouldn't get into it. Any problem so far? Limits to arbitrage. One of the key limits to arbitrage is there is some risk. All and arbitrage is a zero risk transaction. As there is a risk, so arbitrage trade may be limited, may get limited. So some inherent risk in transaction. Secondly, transaction costs, yes, commissions, or broadly transaction costs may offset the benefit. That can be another limitation. And another limitation can be requirement of capital. So let's say that you have two markets, A and B again, In order, what is arbitrage trade? It is to make a profit without investing any capital. And how do you make it without, how do you make it without investing capital? You short sell in one market and then you take long position in, or cover the short selling position in another market. But for you to short sell in this market, there should be short selling opportunity available. If short selling option is not available in this market, you wouldn't be able to short sell. So that means sometimes capital may be required. That is another limitation. So if you are investing capital, that wouldn't be a true arbitrage transaction. So capital requirement may again limit the arbitrage opportunities or arbitrage, sorry, transactions. Any confusion so far? Okay, so what are the key principles or basic principles of derivative pricing? We discuss one principle as storage cost, or storage cost, or any other cost, not necessarily only storage. Storage is primarily the major cost. Otherwise, if there is any other cost, that needs to be taken into account as well. Then we discuss convenience and benefits. Yes, dividends, or broadly we can call it benefit, convenience, dividend, everything is covered in benefit. And then we discuss the assumption is that markets are arbitrage free. And now moving on to fourth one, which is risk neutral investor. What is a risk neutral investor? Who is a risk neutral investor? Yes. So risk neutral investor is the investor who does not care about risk, or who do not want any premium for risk. He is neither risk averse nor risk lover. So the assumption in pricing derivative or valuing derivative is that investor is risk neutral. Remember these assumptions, this is very important. And when you assume the investor to be risk neutral, then the discount rate that you use to price derivative is risk-free rate. So remember, when you are pricing derivative or valuing derivative, the rate that you will be using to pricing or valuing it would be the risk-free rate.
Yes.
Pricing derivative. So when you price a derivative, or you calculate price of a derivative, or when you calculate value of a derivative, you use certain models for valuation. And in those models or in those pricing or valuation techniques, these are the key assumptions that you take, or these are the key adjustments that you make to the price in coming up with your price. So when you calculate price, these are certain assumptions that will remain be consistent throughout all the derivatives. No matter what derivatives you are pricing or valuing, these assumptions will remain be consistent throughout. Okay, so remember these four key assumptions before we go into actually pricing the derivatives. Anyone having any confusion, any questions so far? Sorry? So short sell means that you, for example, there is an asset X. You think that its price today is $100. You think that the price will fall to $90 after one week, 2 weeks, 1 month or whatever. So you want to benefit from this fall. How do you benefit from an asset? You can buy an asset, its price go up and you benefit. But here you want to benefit from fall in its price. So how do you benefit? You can benefit through a short sell transaction. So what you do, let's say you are A. So you go to another party who have this asset, let's say B. You ask B that I want to borrow this asset. You are not borrowing any money, you are borrowing asset. So you take asset X from B. You have borrowed it, and when you borrow it, there will be some condition. You would say I will return it, for example, after 1 week. So you borrowed this asset, you haven't invested any money. Now you go to market and sell it in the market. You sell it in the market. And when you sell it, what price would you sell it for? $100. Now let's say 1 week passes by, or 4, 5, 6 days, whatever passes by, and the price has dropped. So market price is, let's say now, for example, $95. So you again buy it from market, and when 1 week ends, you sell it to again to B.